Hello, everyone. This is Pittsburgh Pat, and I'm here with Phil Kearney. How are you today?
Fantastic. Thanks.
Awesome. So we met online because Phil is a writer, and he's written some stuff that's been published on DM's Guild. So for all of the Dungeons and Dragons fans out there, this is for you. And so Phil, tell me how you got into writing for DM's Guild. Like what was the impetus? Like, what made you say, okay, I'm going to put something on DM's Guild?
It started well, I've been a D&D enthusiast since 87, back when I was 12. I got some books from my cousins for my birthday and I fell in love with it. And so pretty much since Redbox first edition ADD, that time zone, I've been involved in the hobby. And I never felt compelled to create homebrew content, because throughout the AD&D years, I was still getting my feet, learning, like how the game works, how like I wasn't there were so many ideas and ways to take games that I never ran low on just options to play out. Like there's so many things that I never cashed out the supply. And
Got
then
to.
in third edition, when that came around, it was even more so. It completely just redefined how the game worked. My circle of friends I have on my Discord and stuff, it's the common joke is that Wizards of the Coast makes Magic the Gathering, they take over D&D, they immediately turn D&D into a deck building game. Because it's like you got the 20 level stack where as long as you hit your bare minimum prerequisites, you can start building into prestige classes, which is the same kind of idea of like building color-coded specific decks that are designed to do specific action loops inside of a Magic the Gathering game. Third edition became a means of optimizing and creating your own action loops inside of a round of combat or inside of an adventuring day.
Cool.
So there's a lot of really fun parallels there. And so I never ran out of options there. They were putting out a new book every month, every 3 weeks. And so there was so many options. It was just like, how can I tie together all these different ideas? But then and then fourth edition removed all of that by basically giving you a select menu of limited options. And then fifth edition kind of stepped back towards second edition with a little bit of a fourth edition sensibilities of making it a very simple, retaining the simplicity of the game,
Right.
going back to an older roots. But and then it started to reintroduce a little bit of the deck building with subclasses.
Yes.
So in fifth edition, there was so much less customization. That's I think where a lot of homebrew in general started to explode on the scene. I mean, there was always homebrew on third edition, but again, there was so much depth. That's like, I don't need to do that. I could just do X, Y, and Z and get there on my own with published content that's already approved. So why would I bother homebrewing?
Yeah, so do you think that that's why like Xanathar's and Tasha's came out? Because it do you think that was a reaction to the community like doing their own stuff, and Wizards of the Coast was like, oh, we better catch up on this? Or do you think that was planned? Like it was like, okay, we're gonna put out the player's handbook and we're gonna make this simple so everybody like comes and plays again because it got a little crazy there for a while, and we're gonna make this easy. We'll do like just like roll with advantage or roll with disadvantage, and we'll make the classes relatively straightforward. But then once things got rolling after a year or two, they were like, okay, now people are ready for subclasses and new classes, and everybody's like, well, why can't I play an Aarakocra? And then okay, we'll do that. We'll introduce that kind of feature.
Yeah, I think it was just a natural evolution. I think well, there was also a lot of like downtime activities and like crafting and modifying how to use tools. So it was a general glam up of the stuff that was in more like on the DM side of the screen of like how can I run a campaign? So both of those books added more texture
Yeah.
to that side of the DM screen. I don't know if they already knew building books and having a really wide diversity that splits the audience. I don't know if they just retained that information, because that's what TSR's downfall was.
Yeah.
They had so many things going in so many directions that they bankrupted themselves because nothing ever got enough traction to really hit that S curve. So like Planescape was awesome. Dark Sun was awesome. Birthright was awesome. Ravenloft was awesome. Spelljammer is awesome. That's like five right off the cuff right there. And each of those had like five box sets each. So
yeah.
They really bankrupted themselves through excellent, like all the stuff that we would ever want that we miss in fifth edition is just destruction to their bottom line. So I think they realize, I don't know how far down the rabbit hole they knew that could go, or if they had that in the mind when they were building stuff, but I think Xanathar and Tasha was just a natural extension of, like you said, here's the core books and we want more options. So here's some of the things that we think are cool standout ideas to expand on, and back end DM support to make updates and revisions to that stuff as well. And of course, more spells is an easy seller.
Oh yeah.
I don't know. I think Tasha and Xanathar, because they're like the SCAG, right? The Sword Coast Adventuring's Guide was kind of like Xanathar and Tasha, but it was too lore specific, but not specific enough to really hit the lore files. You know, it's like, we've already seen all this stuff in Forgotten Realms before. What are you really bringing to the table?
Right.
So I think they realized that, I'm going to guess that they realized, you know, diving deep, you'll never go deep enough. So instead, keep it more big number, like big picture, chunky ideas that you can manipulate and drop into your own campaigns however you want, but let's add some more character options so that we have more reasons for more people to buy the books.
Well, speaking of spell, you brought up Spelljammer, so like that's what I've been into lately. So that's really fun. You know, it's got that sci-fi element that appeals to me, but it's still kind of like, it's the campy sci-fi, right? So it's like the Flash Gordon sci-fi kind of thing going on there. It's not the hard stuff, although you could certainly go that direction, I'm sure. But that's what you gave me, what you wrote about the, you wrote a kind of, well, you tell me, like, how do you describe the thing that what you sell on DM's Guild under Spelljammer?
Oh, yeah, sure. Most of the things that I publish on DM's Guild are mechanical stuff, like subsystems.
Okay.
I'm not a really big, like the only subclass book that I headed a project for was Pax and Patrons of Ravnica, which was, there's 10 guilds in Ravnica. So we converted all of those guilds into otherworldly patrons for warlocks to take. So when you took one of those guilds, you became a guild mage, which is like a modified version of a warlock where the guild itself becomes your patron. We had different means of like, how would the patron, how would that guild communicate with you, by like a messenger or like a handler, or like mysterious stuff would appear on the wall that only you could see because
cool.
Like you're a mirror, so you have blue black magic, so only you could see that combination happening on walls. So you got these phantom messages that you had to follow.
Nifty.
But that's like the only, that's the only real subclass book that I've been deeply involved in. The rest of it is subsystems. You had asked what got me into building on the DMs.
Yes.
It was because when the Guildmaster's Guide to Ravnica in 2017 came out, I think there was a lot of expectation that we would get some chunky identity involving color magic from the Magic the Gathering setting brought into D&D. But what they did was, instead, they kind of deconstructed magic into a narrative piece that would then fit into the spell slot eight schools mechanics that are core to D&D, which really defined for me like what their mentality moving forward for the rest of their books would be, was to reduce the amount of tech needed for any specific adventure, game setting, or world, break it down so what we already have already works. So that was actually a really big disappointment, because third edition was just rife with subsystems. Tome of Blood, like the Tome of Battle, Book of Nine Swords, Incarnum, Legacy Weapons, Savage Species. These were all deep mechanical systems that created new ways to approach campaigns and character design, and that would get blended together into like a 120-page book or something. Like, here's character options, here's DM options, here's magic items, here's spells, here's subclasses, here's races, and here's like 15 different adventure ideas to take all these things and build them in. And that'd be a book. And then they just book, 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 just keep kicking them out.
Yeah.
So when MTG stuff happened, it was just Boros has fire angel magic, and here's the kind of classes and races and subclasses that would be there. So since there wasn't a color identity that created, that's like, well, they're not going to do it, so I should. So I created a 5-color mana system, which was takes away the 8 schools, takes away spell points, and instead translates all the magic spells and creatures into the 5 colors, and then have a mana system of spell points where if you want to throw a fireball, it's a 3rd level spell, it's a red spell, have 1 point of red mana and then 2 points of other mana out of your spell point pool, and now you're casting your spell. So if I want to be like in a campaign, I'm in a Curse of Strahd campaign right now. We're 4th level. I'm playing a divine sorcerer worshiper of Salune, and the best way to represent that in color from the way that we're approaching it would be Selesnya, which is like white and green magic.
Okay.
It's radiant, it's healing, it's blessing, it's goodness to humanity, and it's natural. So we have like a lycanthrope in our party. We have a moon druid. And I got the Salune character, and all the mana is blue green, white green, and it all just like radiant, like a radiant bolt is white, healing is both white and green, web is green, bless is white. It's like all the things as a divine sorcerer, all the grab bag cool stuff that you can get from both of those spell lists, I can compile, and they just naturally fall into that color alignment of this is exactly the kind of character I want.
Yeah.
I have a mana pool that can reflect my character, like in a ludo narrative where I'm using game mechanics that are now reinforcing the narrative of what my character's identity is. And that's kind of what like MTG is. So that's what got me into 5e. But then from there, I'm like, well, we're not going to see deep mechanical design from the 5e team. That's not what they're doing with 5e.
Right.
So if you want to have a deeper depth of mechanics to reflect that flavor of your campaign by having mechanics that reinforce the flavor, you're going to have to do it yourself.
Right. And you did. So what I've read of your book is that the one that I've read is, you know, you have like ship to ship combat, which I really am investigating. That's a lot of fun because right now, a friend of mine, she's running a low level Spelljammer campaign. We're all like Academy cadets, right? So yeah, so we're like at Starfleet Academy or whatever, and we're cut-ups and we have to deal with bullies and all this stuff. But now we're starting to get on missions. And tonight, actually, it'll be interesting to see. I think we're going on a Spelljammer mission. So, and it'll be neat to see how she does it, not having your mechanics, but you've spelled it all out. So like, let's say like, just to give people an example, if you're the DM and I'm like a crewmate and I'm like on deck with like a, you know, a cannon, you know, like mounted on the rail. Like, you know, how does that work? So how do you do like turns in combat? How do you do like, you know, damage? Do you do it just like hit points for a character, or do you have like strong points? Do you have like, you know, like, okay, the hull takes this many points, this happens, or, you know, no, I want to target the engines, you know, that kind of thing. So, cause I came into role playing from, I played D&D, but then we really got into Traveler, which had a lot of these kinds of things, right? A lot of space stuff, space combat. So,
yeah. So I picked up the Spelljammer box set. I think it was like an 89, maybe it was 90. Right out of B. Dalton bookstore. It's like right off the shelf, tore off the paper, and fell in love with it immediately. And it became pretty much a default background radiation in all my campaigns ever since, just because of having a mobile base that you can park and orbit over something and then like Star Trek drop down onto the planet and explore
right
what you want. It's just the flavor is amazing. And then Planescape came out. It just seemed so obvious. Fourth edition leaned into this with the Astral Sea, and then you picked that up for fifth edition to be able to connect the multiverse together. So all my homebrew campaigns ever since have had this idea, have had this grounding where you leave your planet, you're going to end up in the astral, it'll take you to the outer planes. I'm a big Eberron enthusiast.
Oh, I like Eberron, yeah.
Yeah, so if you go underground, you get into Kyber, and then Kyber eventually leads you like to what the lower planes are in the Eberron verse. So the way that I look at it is, if you delve down deep enough, you end up like in the Abyss or Tartarus, which you could then take out into the Astral, which you could then travel through to wild space to re-enter Eberron. So it becomes a toroid, where you can just cycle through different realities by delving through different locations, and like physical space will take you to different realms. And if you have ships that can take these journeys, you always have your home with you, regardless of where you are in Planescape, Spelljammer, Eberron, Forgotten Realms. So I think there was a lot of excitement when they declared they were going to be releasing Spelljammer in August 2022. There was a lot of excitement because we had already had Saltmarsh, which was, here's some basic naval boat mechanics
for right.
you to kick a boat around the ocean. And then they had Descent into Avernus, where they had Infernal War Machines, which was, if you want to drive Mad Max trucks, here's some basic ideas that go behind that. And these were entire appendices, like 20, 30 pages of content in each of the adventures that those things were presented in. So there was naturally a lot of excitement around Spelljammer bringing in that same level of depth for aerial combat or astral combat, space combat. It's just like three-dimensional chess, literally, to be able to fly around. But what we got was about half a page of basic air gravity mechanics. And then if you want to use ship combat, refer to Saltmarsh, which again goes back to the minimalism that is built into 5e, where we acquiesced and built out some naval mechanics, but since ships are basically just are basically sailing through the astral sea, we can just use the same Saltmarsh rules. And I think that was universally insufficient. I don't think anyone was really satisfied with that.
Right.
So again, just like with Magic the Gathering, it's like, well, hold my beer.
Well, they presented us with, in the August 22 release, they presented us with all these amazing ships, right? And they're mostly, you know, like spiders and squids, and like they have these wonderful shapes. They have these wonderful functions, and they're organic. You know, they've got this kind of organic shape to them. And so you think, okay, what's going to distinguish a squid ship from a, you know, a spider ship? Like, there should be, you know, and then, you know, unique features of each. And then how do you, of course, you want them, you know, like everybody loves battle bots, right? You want to see these things like fight each other, right? Like, who's going to win, you know? Like, is Superman beat Batman? Does the spider ship beat a squid ship? Well, it depends, right? So,
And so that most of that was just kind of hand waved. So I had already been working on more in-depth mechanics for Infernal War Machines because I love Mad Max and I love convoy battles.
Yeah.
So I was already playtesting, and it was proving really successful to have a more 5e style of combat for vehicles, where Infernal War Machines, if they are moving at 10 times the speed of people, like 30, 60 miles per hour, and that means they're going to have a move speed of, like, instead of 30 feet per round, it's going to be like 300 feet per round. So the easiest way to express that in D&D combat is to take a 5-foot square and make it a 50-foot square.
Yeah, if you're using your game mat, sure.
Yeah, absolutely. So now your Infernal War Machine is moving 6 squares as an object interaction. Instead of walking, you're using object interaction to steer and push the pedals to make the thing go, but it's still 6 squares. It's just at 50 feet instead of 5. So if you're fighting ship to ship and you're in separate squares, and you're like launching harpoon flingers and wrecking balls and ballistas and catapults at each other, if you're in separate spaces, it's the same thing as if your character, like if you had a goblin on the back of an artificer's steel defender, you know, basically running around inside your own little square, interacting with other things in their own squares. But since these Infernal War Machines are like a tormentor is like 20 feet. So if you get close enough to be adjacent, then you could zoom in.
Yes.
So instead of being at 50-foot squares, you're now inside of a 10 by 10 grid of 5-foot squares. That's your 50-foot space, and both vehicles are now basically grappling with each other inside of that mutual space.
So that's what I, you know, that's the way I run it. So I've run situations where I'll have two mats at the same table, you know, so we'll have big, if we have a big enough table, otherwise you got to like swap them out. But yeah, it's like, okay, are we boarding now? We're boarding now. So this is what's happening. So, you know, but during the pursuit, that's the interesting part. So it's like, you know, it's like the old pirate sailing ship novels, you know, it's like, well, how do you slow this faster ship down, right, in order to board this ship? Like, what are you doing? Like, well, we're gonna launch, you know, we're gonna load the cannons and launch, you know, like what do they call it when they have the two cannonballs that have chains, it just like destroys the rigging, whatever they call that shot. Well, there has to be some kind of equivalent, right, in order to like slow a ship if you're going to be a bunch of space pirates. Or vice versa, if you're going to be attacked by space pirates,
right,
there has to be a way for the ships to meet, right? Because that's ultimately what you want. So, you know, I mean, if you want to do purely like, you know, Space Invaders video game where you're just like, pew, 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 oh, we just shot down 12 ships, you can do Armada combat too. And you actually have a mechanic for that, which is awesome. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
yeah.
The entire system uses 5e action economy. It's exactly the same if you know how to fight a goblin in a dungeon, you know how to pilot a ship and fight an enemy ship. You've got the same grid, except that depending on the size of your ship, it's going to be 50 foot or a 500 foot grid. The 100 million miles is the amount of distance a spell jamming ship can fly per day. And if you deconstruct that from 24 hours to 2 hours to 10 minutes to 1 minute to one round, it breaks down to 10,000 miles per round, which then translates into a grid to 1,000 miles per square is the maximum speed that a ship can fly. But if I'm 3 squares away, that's 3,000 miles away. There's no way in hell I'm going to hit you with a spell or a catapult too far. So that means that with the primitive, if this was a sci-fi game, we could play with those mechanics. But with such a with the Age of Sail technology that we're using, the way that we have it is, if you're more than a mile away, it's going to take more than a round for your ballista to get to your target. If you're sneak attacking, they don't see you coming. It's a surprise attack. You can attack them at that extreme range with disadvantage, but they don't see it, so you have advantage. So it's actually just an attack.
Yeah.
It's just an attack roll, right?
Yeah.
But if you're over a mile away and you see it, you can literally see it coming from a mile away. You just get out of the way and it shoots by. So you can't hit people unless you're within a mile. So that forces a tight zone of engagement.
Yeah.
So if we're using 500, like a squid ship's 250 feet long, that's like a pixie in a 5 foot square. It occupies that space, but it doesn't fill it.
Right.
So have two ships adjacent to each other at 500 foot squares and be engaged in fire with each other. But then you need to scale in and close to actually be able to board each other. So you can use just basic 5E movement mechanics of, if I can get close enough to you, I can then grapple you or board your ship, like harpoons with ropes attached to them, allow you to do grappling at range. So if you hit them and the rope holds, then you're effectively grappling that ship. They can't get away with you until they can cut the lines or somehow shake themselves off.
Right.
All these ships that are shaped like animals, they all have like these appendages, right?
Yes.
You can make those piercing weapons.
They sure. Have rules
like if you use a piercing ram, you automatically get to make a grappling check as you like stab into the hull of the ship.
Sure.
You have a bludgeoning. You can scuttle a craft. And scuttling is when you hit somebody and you force their gravity to roll over.
Nice.
So everyone on board takes falling damage unless they use a reaction to brace themselves for impact.
Nice.
So you can potentially knock a pilot out of his chair, disabling the ship until it's their turn again. And which basically you have like free shots on them. You can easily board the craft, or you can like add more weapons to grapple, like the Night Spider, the 200 foot Niyogi spider ship. It's got 8 claws and often depicted with netting in between its legs. You can just use net mechanics to hook in. If you're a 200 foot ship and you're fighting a 100 foot flying fish, it's literally like a giant spider creeping over a fly that's caught up in its webs.
And yeah.
Now you've got Umber Hulks coming down the limbs to board your crew and like to hypnotize your siege crews and throw them overboard so they can't fight anymore, but they can get enslaved because you don't have to eat or kill them. You can just throw them off the deck And then the Yogi just come by with their net and swoop them up. And now you're part of the Niyogi army. Enjoy being hypnotized your entire life. And
Right,
so they have
right.
like really crappy siege crews because they're all starving to death. They're all slaves versus the free people that are trying to keep themselves from being enslaved. Like, so
There's so
there's
much great stuff there. Yeah, it's
yeah,
it.
it's crazy flavors. So you can stay at this 500-foot scale until it catches you in your net. And now you're zooming into the 5-foot scale where they're actually boarding your deck and attacking you like they would assume combat would be. And so you can have like, and like in a virtual tabletop, I use Roll 20, and then like you can have 100 by 100 square grid. But like at a kitchen table, that's inconvenient. It's so like you can just
Yeah.
grab a pizza box and like have a grid on the pizza box
Yeah.
where you can just have like your ship is this pizza box. You just set it aside until you need it again. We're at the 500-foot scale, we're engaging in combat, so we're just going to use our normal grid. But as soon as I'm within boarding range, let's grab the pizza box and start putting people on the. There's your ship. So you can
Yeah.
just decide. But like in a virtual tabletop, you've got infinite space to do that stuff.
Yeah,
You
if you're using Roll
grab a ship
20,
and
yeah.
zoom in on it, and you're ready to go.
So I'm a Adventure League in person at a game store DM. So we're actually using like, miniatures and mechanic, like actual like physical objects. But I do know what you mean. So like I have one that's like a set that's just like a board. It's cardboard with overlays on it. You unfold it into six sections, and that's a nice small one. That's good for like the ship, and then for the space one, it's a big rollout thing. I wanted to ask you a little bit specifically about DM's Guild and publishing on DM's Guild, and there's a lot of people that watch my channel that are interested in the writers, and they may be interested in doing that. I know I am personally interested in. I have a Spelljammer Adventure League kind of homebrew, a little bit of homebrew thing that I did that I really would like to publish there. So what is the process like when you go through to write the, I mean, obviously the writing part of it is the main thing, but once I get something together, what, how do I, are there certain parameters I have to abide by in order to publish on DM's Guild? And can I actually make money doing it? Like, or is it just kind of a hobby kind of thing?
Sure. Yeah. It's there's not a lot of rules. They have a restriction on which campaign settings can be used. Generally, if it's something that Wizards has published, you can use that setting like Dragonlance, Ravnica, Spelljammer, Planescape, Ravenloft, Theros. These are all different worlds that they released. And as they release new setting books, generally those books, those settings become available for anyone to be able to turn out content. Like Greyhawk is unavailable. Mistara is unavailable because they haven't
Gotcha.
technically published those as settings in fifth edition. So those are off limits. But generally there's a 50% cut that gets taken off of you. So if you
Okay.
sell something for $5, you're going to get at best 250 out of it.
Okay, see, that's
Because
good for people to know.
yeah, a portion of that goes to one bookshelf, the company that controls DriveThruRPG, what is it, Pathfinder Unlimited, as well as the DMs Guild. They're the administrating site that oversees this stuff. And then there's a publisher. And Wizards of the Coast is technically the publisher for any content that's on the DMs Guild, just like Paizo is technically the publisher for anything on, no, it's Infinite. It's called Pathfinder Infinite. That's what it's called. But they are technically the publisher. So they technically own rights.
Okay, so
However,
once, so what you're doing as a writer is you're selling your rights to them.
yeah,
So
or
you
a
don't,
portion.
so once you give that to DM's Guild, or once you give that to Wizards of the Coast, that's their property. That's their intellectual property now, right? That no longer belongs to you as the writer.
That is correct.
Okay.
That
People
is
need to be
correct.
clear on that, right? You won't just go publish this anywhere else now.
Yeah,
Like
no, yeah. Once
you're under a
then,
legal contract not to publish this anywhere
yeah.
else.
The only place you could then publish it is on the DMs Guild specifically. So if you're going to publish content, if you aren't using a Wizards of the Coast IP, you're throwing money away and you're not making use of the tools that are there. The audience for 5e content has expanded to the point where you don't need DMs Guild to be able to garner an audience. It just needs to be 5e stuff. You just need to push it out. But if you are using, like I'm such like I said, I picked up Spelljammer back in like 1990, and I've been obsessed with it ever since. So if I have, for me personally, if I have the opportunity to publish something and I can actually slap the Spelljammer logo on it, actually use squid ships, actually use Nyogi, actually use a tyrant ship. I'm going to use all that stuff because that's the stuff that I've been using for the past 30 years already anyway.
Gotcha.
But you can't, you cannot copyright or patent mechanics. It's like all the stuff that are in all these different books, you can extract them as game mechanics and then reflavor stuff to be your own thing.
Okay.
So you go, you really want to think about, am I on DM's Guild because I am in love with the IP and I want to embellish the content, the setting that this is built for, or am I just doing my own thing? If I'm doing my own thing, that becomes Kickstarter territory, DTRPG, your own website. You can publish it anywhere because you'll own it.
Sure. So but
the content, you have to think about that stuff.
Yeah. One of the advantages, though, to obviously publish on DM's Guild is that that's where everybody goes to look at stuff. So your level of visibility is going to be much greater than if you just start your own little website. If I just start a website tomorrow, nobody knows about that. But everybody knows about DM's Guild. So if I publish a couple modules there, then my name gets out there. Then maybe, you know, I have
a... It's a safe harbor for you to learn how to steer your own boat.
As a okay.
So it's not great. It's we're all kind of hoping that the 2024 releases are going to reinvigorate the market, but it is about 25% of what it used to be.
Okay.
So it's
gotcha.
A much harder struggle now, but there are so many third parties that are in the Kickstarter self-publishing space now.
So that's why, because the Kickstarter stuff, that's what's taken away the stuff from DM's Guild.
Yeah, because there's not much, because of all the mishandling of PR by WotC, there was a large amount of distrust that was injected, and a real, there was already a bit of a, the pandemic was explosive for anyone that was already established in the RPG space, and people that were creating content during that time on DM's Guild as well were really seeing a lot of growth. But once the pandemic was over, and missteps in PR were being taken, there was a sharp drop.
Gotcha.
And so a lot of there's more and more business going into Kickstarter self-publishing. DTRPG, you can be on DTRPG, your own websites. There's a IO sites. There's anywhere you want to go. As long as it's not Wizards IP, you can do anything you want with 5e. And
gotcha.
More and more people are seeing that if you don't want to use the IP specifically, why? Because the amount of money that you're, honestly, the amount of money that you save, like Wizards takes like 15%, for instance, and DTRPG, one bookshelf takes 35%. That's where your 50% off comes from.
Gotcha.
If you're going to self-publish and say it's a $10 book and you're going to lose $5 for every sale, that technically means you can invest $5 of advertising to get $5 back on the sale of a book.
Right,
so you
right.
Can start building your own audience in that manner. The only reason I haven't done it yet is because I'm still getting out of my heart all the fanboy that I've built up over 30 years.
Okay.
Years. So but all
you know the business model, but you're not doing it yet.
It's a side hustle for me. I started off as an illustrator.
Nice.
Some
of the artwork is amazing in that module. So is that that's your own original, like, wow.
I stream all my art on YouTube. I stream every day, Monday through Friday in the mornings, whatever book I'm in the process of publishing. I do all the token art and all the book art online.
Okay.
And just basically talk about, or not talk about, but when I talk about it, it's going to be whatever it is that's on my mind, or like when I was doing the Spelljammer book and I was drawing ships fighting each other, it just gave me a ton of space for me to think things through and talk it out loud and talk about the narrative that goes on behind it. And then people would show up and they'd have ideas about, what do you want to put on that guy's shield? I don't know. What do you want on that guy's shield?
Yeah, that's amazing. It's amazing the synergy you get once you get one or two other people involved in a conversation like this, or anything other else, like, because when I write and then I give it to like somebody to edit and they come back with more ideas, it's like, yeah, that's, I didn't think about that. That's beautiful. I don't know why I didn't think about that.
And then you're going through the book creation process, and like you wrote out the thing and it's solid. And then when I start injecting artwork into it, is like, you know, I never really thought about this. This kind of, maybe I want to change the narrative I have over here in the text because I like what's going on in the picture more than I like what's going on in that paragraph.
Yeah.
Since I'm
Sure.
picturing both of those things, I just use Microsoft Word to build my documents. So I can just go on and just change up the typing, push the text around a little bit, make sure it fits.
Yes.
And drop the picture next to it, and there you go. So
cool.
It's really easy. And Microsoft Word, it's most people have it for free if they use Windows. So that's why I've continued to use it, because I use Photoshop for my art program, and I don't I only publish PDFs. I don't actually publish print books. So it's easy for me to not have to worry about CMYK color corrections and having specifications. Like you have to use Adobe file, like Illustrator files to send off to publishing houses so that you, when you get your proof back, it looks the way that you want it to.
Right.
But when you don't actually publish a physical book, you don't have to worry about that stuff. So
right.
As long as you can slap a PDF together, you can upload it and then push it out and gets purchased.
So do you have a whole library of PDFs out there that people can look at? So,
yeah.
Okay, where are they? Give us a little bit of a push.
All my book stuff is on Phil Kearney. If you do a search for Phil Kearney, FilKearney, that's my YouTube channel. That's my Patreon. That's my Discord. That's my identity on DMs Guild. I've done some freelance writing on DTRPG with Inkwell Games. So you can find my content through that.
Cool.
And if like I started doing freelance illustration back in 2000 when Pay on Demand and the OGL first got released. That's when we first started seeing third party content creation get taken into the individual hobby space. It became possible for hobbyists like myself to be able to build books.
Yeah.
And actually build industry out of it. So, but back then it was difficult to get color. So everything was just black and white, either grayscale, pen and ink sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And that was awesome for me. I'm colorblind, so I don't see any color.
Yeah.
So it was great that the industry at that time, all they wanted really was pen and ink art. And
well,
I got obsessed with artwork from the D&D books that were all ink wash,
right?
Grayscale stuff. So
that's right.
That was amazing. And
some of that artwork was incredible. Some of it, yeah, I still love looking at my old D&D books. But
yeah.
But you mentioned this is a side hustle for you, right? So, you know, to those people who are like, say somebody's out there, they're like 16 years old, 17 years old, and they're like, hey, I'm not going to get a job. I'm going to go ahead and do this for a living. Is that realistic?
No.
Yeah.
No,
okay.
No, not at all.
All right.
I've got like maybe a dozen books on the DMs Guild, and I'm still pull less than $1,000 a month from it.
Right.
So gotcha. You have to really be a machine to be able to build up enough momentum to be able to take off. And that takeoff path could be anywhere from 3 to 15 years.
Yeah. And you can't run out of ideas.
Yeah. Yeah.
which
is another reason why I like the DMs Guild so much, is because every time Watsy puts out a book, it's like, I've got like 5 ideas I can do off of that, but it's all their IP.
Right.
So, but again, it's DMs Guild is a great place to cut your teeth, to learn like what's a good looking book, how can I build adventures, what's fluff versus crunch, how efficiently can I do this, do I need to work with other people, can I build a pipeline of production allies that I know I can get good editing, I can get,
yes,
get good artwork. Like, this is all a very safe space to explore that stuff. And once you're ready to jump out of the nest and fly on your own, you'll already know what you're doing. And since you approach it as a hobby in the first place, it's like you can potentially keep the fun of doing it.
Yes.
As you continue to expand. Like I've got like maybe another 2 or 3 years worth of DMs Guild stuff left in me before I'll start doing Kickstarters for completely different stuff. But I've built such a large library. And it's all free preview. Like you can peel open any of my books on DMs Guild and thumb through it. But I also give you like anywhere from 10 to 120 token map, other assets if you buy it. So it's like, look at it, like just like B. Dalton. I mentioned that I bought Spelljammer for B. Dalton. I was a teenager, like from age 12 to 16, I would go to the same bookstore at the local mall in St. Louis, Missouri, And I would show up with a Coke. I would grab a book off the shelf. I'd go back to the kids section, sit down, and read for 3 hours while my sister was kicking around with her friends.
Right.
But management never had a problem with me being there. I cleaned up after myself. I cleaned up the kids' area a little bit, and they knew that every 3 weeks I'd get enough lawnmower money to be able to go in and buy a book for $14.
Yeah.
So they're like, "Yeah,
No.
you're gonna show up, you're gonna buy a
Dude.
book. What are you getting this time, Phil?" So I'm gonna grab the Dungeoneer Survival Guide. That thing looks awesome because I've already read it twice. So that mentality of let people see what it is that you're offering, so they know that when they buy it, they already want to give it 5 stars because.
Yeah, okay, so that's pretty cool. That I've interviewed a bunch of people and we talked about Kickstarter and we've talked about Patreon and my one buddy he's now a friend that I interviewed just cut through this process. And that's the reason I love doing YouTube is because I get to talk to people and now I've got friends all over the world that, you know, I would never, but after you talk to somebody who's got the same interest as you do for an hour, like all of a sudden you're like you're kin, you know? So like I talked to this dude in Italy, you know, and he's like, he said what you said, like find other people that like to do what you don't like to do. And then he's like, don't try to do it all yourself. If you try to do it all yourself, like you're gonna be in, because there's always a part of the process that either you're not good at or you just don't want to be good at. Like you just don't care to do. And if you're lucky enough to find somebody else, so he has a collaborator, so there's two. But and then the other guy that I mentioned who I'm kind of buddies with. In fact, now we're doing Dolmenwood in person together. We found out we live within a few miles of each other, even though we met at a convention. Yeah. And we're going through this really crunchy, like the old school D&D adventure where like you have like three, like the wizard had 2 hit points. Like you do not, you
That's
don't just
awesome.
pick a fight. You know, it's not 5e where there's no consequences to a fight and you have death saves. Like there's none of that. But he
That's cool.
said, when do you start a Patreon? He's like, yesterday. And I'm like, I don't know. I guess I've never started a Patreon. He's like, no, there are people out there that want to support your creative pursuits. And I'm like, yeah, but what do I do? What do I give them? You know, like what do I give them in return? Like, so like for your Patreon, what do you do for your Patreon? Like, is there, is
I put
it,
all my playtesting stuff there.
so it's a quid pro quo kind of thing? Like somebody can get free material there and
I'll eventually start putting stock art on there. I hate doing packaging. It's the only thing that keeps me from being able to build a business, really, is I don't
yeah.
like doing packaging. The more time I spend advertising something is the less time I have to actually build something worth advertising. So
Right.
it's kind of a catch 22 for me, which I'm still sussing through, but I'll
Yeah.
figure it out someday.
Yeah.
But yeah, on page like my spell jam, like the 107 page spell jammer book that I have, the entire thing was available for people to chew on my Patreon.
Oh,
You
cool.
don't even have to be a member. It's like here, it's just here's a link, go play with it.
So while you're
Thank you.
building it, they get to look at it and give you ideas. So that so there's that too, which like they'll give you input and you know, unsolicited. And so
And my Patreons are the first people that have access to a playtest. I'm building a martial power system right now. It's an alternate spell magic system for martials that full casters don't have access to. It's like a bunch of like strikes, maneuvers, exploits, reactions, sustained effects that gives martial characters the same breadth of options and exponential option building every level. Like it's framed off of half casting, but it's got like 200 unique powers that are not spells.
well,
Like
5e
what?
needs that
Yeah,
definitely because,
if I knock you down, I get a free reaction to attack you because you're prone,
yeah,
for
or
example.
something. Because, like, you know, barbarians, you play a barbarian, it's fun for a little while, but then everybody else, the wizards over here, like casting counter spell and calling down meteor swarms, and you're like, I'll swing my axe, you know, for the 15th time, you know, it's like,
But
can.
it's a resource system, so you build out a bunch of stuff, you give. It's kind of like a more in-depth arcane archer, battle master, bard inspiration, monk martial artist sort of design space. And that
Yes.
full document has been available on my Patreon for about a year now since I've been building it. And now we're playtest. I place it with my home table. I run a campaign from level 1 to 20 in about 200 to 250 hours. And then start a new campaign over at first level. And so I have an ongoing home table that I build with. And when I was building this, we were 16th level. So I started injecting, like we had an arcane art, we had an arcane trickster, a druid, a paladin, and a ranger. All of them had martial aspects. Like while the druid was wild shaped, she could use these different martial power ideas. So I had the opportunity to test it at the high end, 16th to 20th level.
Yeah.
We had a ton of resources and a lot of firepower and tons of hit points to throw around. So it made sense. But now that we're really far along in the document's production, we have to go back to the very beginning. It's like, it feels great at high end. How does it feel at third level?
Well, that's like earlier you mentioned that you had a moon druid in one of the parties. And it's like everybody's a moon druid now, because if you're anything other than a moon druid, you can't, you know, CR, you know, rating goes up to one, right? Or two, actually, I think in the early levels, it's like you're being a moon druid's broken at the early levels. But, you know, I mean, it doesn't make sense. So, I mean, when I played my first druid, I was like, they're like, oh, well, what's your circle? And I'm like, I don't know, grasslands or something. They're like, why aren't you a moon druid? I'm like, because I don't know any better. But then you find out later, you know. But it's just funny. People see, I play D&D from a not an optimize the mechanics kind of. I play it more from an acting background, more of a character. I want to play a character. It doesn't matter to me what the best choice is. It's what would this character do, right? So it doesn't, you know, yes, this character could like pummel this NPC and into submission, but that's not what this character is about. This character is about diplomacy and, you know, or he has a chivalric code that he abides by or something of that nature. And so, you know, I love the mechanics that can inform that, you know, which is awesome. Like I love the idea of your patron, like having warlocks that have patrons that are organizations instead of you know, forces, like, or yeah. Not forces, you know, deities or demons or something like that. So I love that idea. It's like your patron is the guild,
yeah,
which makes a lot of sense, right? So it's
especially
like,
in Rapid Cup.
Yeah, it's like so. Oliver Twist or something, like, you know what I mean? Like yeah. He's, you know, you're not idolizing an individual. Or like the Thieves Guild in Skyrim or something. Like you're part of an organization that's bigger than you, right?
Yeah.
And that's an awesome idea. I love that idea.
Yeah, absolutely. So playtesting stuff at like my patrons. If I'm gonna do a playtest, I'll put out the dates and paying members on the Patreon, they have first right to a chair.
First dibs, gotcha.
Or if there's like a tie, my patrons always break the tie. But I also have a Discord channel where I can pick up more casual fans or casual participants.
Nice.
And so between the two of them, I have a pool of players that are always interested in doing something. So like I'm putting out I'm building Mecha and War Titan machinery for the, as an expansion for the Spelljammer book that I published. And so probably in the next couple of weeks, we'll take the Big B's book, Might of the Giants. At the back end of that, there's a scenario where you're raiding a fire giant's fortress, and the scale is 20-foot squares. So what we would do is we would equip the characters with war titans that are 15 or 20 feet in size, then go fight giants at the same scale as they are with the same size weapons. I can bash, trip, grapple, steal the weapon off of the fire giant and then start hitting it because I've got a 20-foot mecha that's running.
Yeah, that's pretty awesome. I love that idea.
Yeah, it uses the exact same mechanics. I mean, it's the exact same mechanics that are already inside the Spelljammer book that I published, except that it's just like fighter craft are any ships that are up to 50 feet or smaller in size,
right,
while vessels are larger than 50 feet, like a squid ship, like a night spider. The Nyogi 200-foot metal spider ship, that's a vessel. But now we also have in that book 40-foot spiderlings, which are spider craft.
Sure.
They've got a ballista on the back. They've got enough like two harpoon flingers from Descent into Avernus, and they've got a bunch of grappling claws. So when they stab into your ship, they can sink in and hold onto the helm, onto the ship, so you can't shake them off. So they didn't have boarding crews. Like grappling mechanics is a big issue to think about when you're working from 5 to 50 to 500 foot scales. So we had to come up with a mechanic called holding, which is I've grappled you, but I can't control you because you're too big.
Right.
But now you're going to have to make a grappling check to get rid of me. Otherwise, I'm just going to ride inside your gravity plane, and I can have a whole cloud of fighter ships just riding inside your gravity plane, peppering you to death while you're trying to figure, like you'll have to disengage to be able to break them out of your gravity plane to try to yeet out and escape from them. But then they can pursue and pace you.
Yeah.
So now you're just doing like a road chase through space where they're just still gunning after you. Well, let's go into an asteroid field to see if I can shake them off.
Yeah, like in which was it, Revenge of the Sith, where they have the Obi-Wan and Anakin are in the fighters at the beginning of the.
I love that scene.
Yeah, and they got the robots that like attach to their fighters and start destroying the ship, just start pulling stuff out, you know, at random.
Exactly like that. I was watching that a lot when I was building the book. Macross Plus, I don't know if you're an anime guy or not. If you've
I
seen,
do like some anime, yeah.
Macross Plus, I think it was like 19, I want to say it was like 1996. It was a 2 hour mini movie based off of like Robotech, Macross, all those things, like transformable jets into robots and they fight giants, right?
Right.
Macross Plus was a great expansion. It was basically about two test pilots that were competing against each other for the new Veritech fighter pilot design, like which ship is better. And these two guys grew up knowing each other. They have this whole rivalry thing, but they're basically just high elite test pilots that were excellent combat ratios. So when they would fight, like they would be flipping, like transforming from jet to Gerwalk to robot, launching silos of missiles, yeeting out, blocking shots. It was like really fast, dynamic dogfight combat.
Nice.
And like there's scenes where they're just like one of the characters is basically taking on a squad of Zentradi fighter ships and it's just dusting them. But the way that he's maneuvering stuff, you can see the distancing, like he's scaling to 50 feet here. He's taking about 4 steps and now he's engaging it with some ranged attacks. Now he's close enough that he's spearing it with a knife on the end of his a bayonet. He's got like a 10-foot long bayonet that's probably going to do like 50, 60 hit points of damage in D&D terms when he spears the ship and then he gets it over. And then he turns into jet and he flies away. Like it's such sick, fast maneuvering. And that's I think the potential behind dogfighting and ship combat in D&D if you have mechanical language to express.
Yes, that's what we needed. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So that's the thing though. That's one thing I want to emphasize is you found a need, right? So that's the other thing that, you know, so if people out there are listening, you know, yeah, you can do what I'm going to do, which is just write a flavor sketch that something that I ran around like Halloween. And it's basically like, oh, here's a Halloween scenario for Spelljammer. But you can do what you've done, which is way more, you're actually fulfilling a need, which is, you know, I want to have ship to ship combat, but I'm not exactly sure how to do it. And you've got it all written out already. So like, it's really easy to, for somebody to like pick up your PDF and go, oh, this is how you do it. Because
You spell it all out. You provide maps. You do I have arrows and stuff, like point how ships move. Like if you want to go really deep into the weeds of it, like here's deep mechanics, but like, you don't need to have any of that. If you don't want to, if you just want to play it theater of the mind, you now have a wealth of information about how these mechanics work.
Yes.
So if you don't want to go through the painstaking process of actually maneuvering on a board like you would inside of a dungeon, if you've got 6 ships that you're fighting against your own and you don't want to have a drawn out battle, you can reduce it down to theater. I like in my own home table, I use theater of the mind like 90% of the time.
Yeah.
But we can all visualize where things are at in the map, and we have the mechanics and the physics that go behind it. Whereas, like, you're being rushed by two spiderlings, they're entering your gravity plane, and one of them is just latched onto the side of your ship. What do you want to do?
Right.
And like, the team knows what that means. It's like, well, the other one hasn't latched on. It's like, yeah, he didn't have enough movement, he couldn't do it. It's like, okay, well, we want to gun at him with the ballista. Meanwhile, our fighter and barbarian are going to jump off the deck onto the spiraling and start cleaving through the Umber Hulk that's getting ready to board our deck.
Right.
Now it's just a 5-foot scale combat while also engaging at a 50-foot combat, but both exist at the same time as either a grid combat or theater of the mind.
Very cool.
Whatever's most convenient for the style of play that you want. But
yeah,
building mechanical systems allows you to have different types of stories. And I'm writing an adventure now for Eberron, and it's the thought process between like subsystem design versus like subclass or character class design versus adventure design. They're like completely different creatures.
Yeah,
like you have to be thinking in different directions with each of them, but they're all meant to work together. So you have to have that common touchstone of like what are we trying to achieve with the thing that we're building, and when we're building it, does it create more options and inspire new stories and new styles of play, or is it like neck bearding and cutting off ideas? And
well,
I'm looking towards stuff that open up new ideas, new means of approaching stuff. So,
and then that's what I also teach D&D to like middle school kids, like an after school kind of thing, and so what I've learned is I rarely say no. So like when the kids, they don't know the rules. Well, some of the kids will like know the rules and then other kids are brand new to it. So
sure.
Some kids will say, you can't do that. That's, you know, you don't have enough movement to do that, you know? And I'll say, I'll somehow adapt the situation so that the kid can have at least a partial resolution too, because nobody wants to have a turn where they're trying to get into combat and they can't get into combat, right?
Yeah.
It's like that first move, like, well, I don't have, like, I only have 30 feet of movement. I can't, like, use my weapon. That stinks, you know? So, like, you know, who wants to, like, sit out for a round? So I always make sure that there's something they can do. And sometimes I have to take the kids that know a little bit more about the rules aside and say, like, hey, the rule number one is the DM makes the rule. So, like, you know, this is all about having fun, you know, and telling a story. So, like, the rules are rules, but, like, you know, let's not let the rules, like you said, like, let's not cut our options because of the rules. The rules are there to make more options available, right? So, so if we do want to have this labyrinthine fighters going through an asteroid field chase, and we think that's going to be fun, let's get the grid down. Let's do it. Let's put all our little figurines down and do that. Or if it's more important for us to shake these guys off our tail so we can get to the base so that we can do the role playing element of it, then keep it in the theater of the mind, right? So, so it just. It depends on what you're trying to do.
Where do you want to invest your time? Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. What kind of a table do you have? Do they like the deep tactics of it where micro decisions is where the fun is for them? And if your whole table agrees on that, then pull out the map and
go. Yeah. I mean, some people really get into the Warhammer, you know, the Star Wars Legion, like that kind of stuff where you're like measuring like distances and ranges and all that kind of stuff. Like some people really get into that, you know.
Yeah.
Most of the stuff that I run doesn't. We don't have that much time. We got 2 hours, 2.5 hours, you know, on in a adventure league. Is some people may never have played D&D before, so it's like, you know, I'm gonna try not to bog them down in that. I'm trying to give them more of the flavor of it, you know.
But
if you've got a campaign that you're running every week and you know each other and you know what each other like, then you can get into that stuff big time.
Yeah, you really customize. That's what I love about 5e is that it's so customizable.
Yeah.
It really is just incredibly modular. You can add character classes, you can add spells, you can add magic items, you can add entire combat systems, alternate magic resources, all that stuff. It's all clip-on. All you're doing is adding to the D20 plus modifier equals result. I mean, that's the core of the game, and it is the best version of D&D because it's so fluid. But it's not like 4E was too dialed in. It was obviously built for a virtual tabletop that apparently never manifested for reasons. But if that had happened, it would have been a very effective Gloomhaven sort of game. But we don't want Gloomhaven. We've learned that over the past 20 years. We've had the MMOs. we've had ultra complicated board games now, and that's not really D&D can be that, but that's like 15% of the pie.
Right.
Like my games are like 80% exploration, 10% social stuff, and
wow,
10% combat.
That's
But
funny.
I consider I consider interrogations, diplomacy, and deception. I consider all that stuff to be exploration.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, because
like if I get into a conversation with you, I'm trying to get information from you. I'm exploring your dialect.
Yes.
I can use an intuition. I can do an intuit roll or a perception check. Like, he told you this, but you know he's holding something back. How
right.
do you want to approach that? And now you're going to oscillate between deception, intimidation, and persuasion during a conversation to try to fish out extra pieces of information. And with that, never say no. I already know like what the base amount of information they're going to get from this. And they love rolling dice. So go ahead and roll a dice every time you engage somebody in conversation. And if you roll well, you'll get an extra piece of information.
Yes.
Like crap, yes. You know you've only gotten the bare minimum. You know there might be something deeper there for you to dig out. How are you going to get to it?
Right.
That's all, in my mind, that's all exploration.
See, that's interesting because I've always thought that my campaigns have been too lax in exploration, but mental exploration is still exploration.
Yeah. I had an idea for a role-playing game where you'd play exorcists and the demons that are inside of you are unresolved trauma. So you're building dungeons inside of the souls of people where the creatures that are inside, their main goal is to avoid light. So all the characters, when they project themselves into this soul dungeon space, they're bringing lanterns and different sources of light to peel away layers of gloom to find the creature that's breaking the heart of your subject, to be able to pull them into the light to release the soul from being captive. And that's like a reframing of the combat space where you're not killing anything, but you're doing AoE and targeted attacks using this revelation of seeing what it is that's infesting this person's heart. And you can peel, as a combat frame, you can peel apart psychological exploration, but you're framing it around combat. So as you dig off pieces, you can get information about like, why is this thing tethered to their stomach? Why does it hurt their stomach when they think about this thing? And you can start peeling pieces apart like that. Like that is something that would.
Yeah, that'd be interesting. It's kind of like a reverse Call of Cthulhu, where like there's a mechanic in Cthulhu where there's madness, right? So like if you experience certain things, there's trauma, or they use it as like sanity, I guess, so you lose sanity points. And actually, I think there's a board game that does it too, like
Arkham. I think it's Arkham Asylum.
Yeah, maybe. I was thinking of Betrayal at Baldur's Gate or something like that, or. Am I right? I might be wrong about that.
I don't know the name.
Yeah, but there's but it's interesting. So you're actually reverse. You're doing the opposite save. So it's like a positive thing. Like you're healing, the character is healing, but you're going through the dungeon to bring light on these dark places. Yeah,
yeah,
I like that.
That's
very
yeah,
positive.
Well, I mean, there's three pillars, right? There's social, there's exploration, and there's combat. Combat has the most mechanics,
right?
Because the game is built around being killed in combat.
Right.
Then there's exploration, which is like ability checks, which is a lesser degree of complexity that has positive, negative, and degrees of success in between, because you're dealing with concise things. Can I climb that wall? Can I get this piece of information? And then you have the most light, which is social, which
right.
technically doesn't need any rolls at all and can run for hours. But what if you flipped it
right.
so that you're doing a dating game? And your ability to get the first date, you have to crit on the things that are interesting in the person that you're romancing. So you're now using combat style mechanics to set up a favorable, like if I can accumulate this many points of favor, this person is going to value me. And I
yes.
And then the exploration level stays the same because I'm now finding out facts about that person that I can then target attacks. I'm like you like this. You'll like me because of that. Like I can notice these exploration things to create advantages for me to do my gesture. And my gesture would be like a hit point total. Like I'm suave. So I'm going to roll a D10 on favor when I'm doing suave stuff as opposed
right.
to physical prowess. I have oppressive. I just I caught your attention because of a game that we're playing in the park, for instance, whatever. And then the combat is completely nothing. Like if there's a combat, it would be like somebody's trying to hit on my date at the bar, and I'm not going to get in a fight with them.
Right.
I'm going to use my mechanics to impress my date by resolving this conflict to demonstrate I'm somebody safe to be around.
Right.
So instead of
Right.
having a combat scenario, I'm now building that into a social slash exploration that then gives me bonuses to my when I'm rolling for favor. So
Yeah,
you can
this.
see you can use the narrative completely separate from those three gears of mechanics to be able to create any kind of game that you want.
I
So
do
that's
like that. And I like the idea of like bringing more of the combat mechanics into the social resolutions, because that's what I like to play. We in the Dolomwood campaign just on Wednesday. Oh, no, Tuesday, 2 days ago. I felt like I lost a day when I slept all day yesterday. We met some crone who lived alone in a cave, and we're trudging through this snowstorm, and I'm like, well, maybe we should go in the cave. So we meet this loner crone in this, but she's got her everything's adorned with like flowers. Like it's like she's made like flowers or painted flowers on all the furniture and that sort of thing. It's a really rich environment. So they're like the other two PCs are, trying to like question her, and I'm like, I'm just gonna go right up to her and say, "Excuse me, lovely young lady." Because she was described as neither lovely nor young, and just say like, "Excuse me, lovely young lady, you seem to be fascinated with flowers. Tell me more about this exquisite art that you seem to be able to make." And as a result, the DM's like, "Okay, give me a charisma check on that, But like, it's way more fun to, you know what I mean? Instead of like, okay, here's our quest giver, let's get the quest, like let's flavor it up, and then have different degrees of like, okay, well, since you drank her or you tasted the awful smelling onion soup that she graciously made for you, therefore she'll give you this bonus as opposed to, just giving you the quest. She'll also like say, okay, if you complete the quest, well, I'll also make a healing potion for you or something like that. So yeah, it's nice to have those layers. And being a DM, making that happen, or having tables that you can roll on for that to happen, which is a lot of fun too,
Absolutely,
so.
and the DM controls the pace and the narrative and the mechanics that are involved with both of those. So it's you just set and once you understand how a skill check works, how an ability check works, it says d20 plus add bonuses. That's all combat really is combat has literal extra steps.
Yeah, it just has some extra steps based on the weapon and range and armor class, things of that nature.
Yeah,
But
it's like I
yeah.
think Dungeon Crawl Classics basically makes spell casting an ability check.
Yeah.
And like if you're using Beckmi or BX like first edition stuff, you have like one attack per round. You move and you have an attack and you're done. Or you move, you cast a spell and you're done. Or you move and you do a rogue thing and you're done. That can all just be ability checks.
Yeah.
And on how good it is at
And
whatever your specialization is depends on how many bonuses you have.
honestly, at the levels that I teach, like I'll be teaching a summer camp in June, and these kids are third grade through fifth grade. So like, yeah, ability checks pretty much where it's at. Like I'm not making them do math with like their bonuses on their, like, okay, make sure you add your dexterity bonus. Is that a finesse weapon? Like it's just, that's a little too much for them at that age. So,
I'm running my current I have a coworker's table. I have a day job. The role playing is a side hustle, so I have a day job and I have a lunchtime team. We call it Lunchtime Adventures, and I have five players, and we play 1 hour a week because it's lunchtime. And this last it's move plus one action, and everything is an ability check.
nice.
And this last session we ran, we got through eight full rounds of everybody plus the DM in 1 hour.
That's
And
pretty
so
good.
it's a Spelljammer Asteroid campaign. Basically, they're playing dwarves, warforged, and gnomes that are extracting ore from asteroids to build their mining guild is basically the background theme of it. But everything is just ability checks. So
Nice.
like if you get attacked, you're going to make a body roll of either strength, dexterity, or constitution as in a very 4E style saving throw. If my mind's being attacked, I could use my charisma, my wisdom, or my intelligence, whichever one fits the attack. And if I'm
Right.
possessed, or if I'm attacking you with a spell, what's is it a like a physical spell? Which stat do you want to use as your ability check to cast that spell? Do you have bonuses to casting spell? Add that on. Otherwise, there you go. And like so we have a degree of one in a very Numenera sort of way on a scale of 1 to 10 is the difficulty challenge.
Right.
And so the die roll that you need is difficulty times 3 plus 1. So a difficulty of 4 is a 13, a 10 is a 31, a roll of 1 is a 4. So whatever roll you get compared to the difficulty of the task, if you blow past it, then you do well, depending on how far over a goal you hit. If you fail the
Yes.
roll, you take damage, or you create complications based on how miserable your die roll was.
Right.
So
I
the
did
whole
the,
so.
yeah.
Yeah,
I
very fast, very,
that
very fast.
that's great. And I do that too. I've stolen it. There was a mechanic in one of the Star Wars role-playing games where you could have a success, but there'd be a consequence. And I do that sometimes with close rolls. I'll say like, oh yeah, you hit the Tyrannosaurus Rex, but then it turns and notices your companion who had formerly been hiding in that tree. So now what do you do? So,
Right,
or
yeah.
you miss, but you distract it long enough for you to be able to take a bonus action and move, 40 feet if you want to, or that sort of thing. And it makes it a little more fun than just saying, ah, you missed. Next,
Right.
so.
The one example, they were exploring a crevasse inside of one of the asteroids. It's a platinum ore site. So they were trying to find pockets of platinum. And so they were doing a basically an investigation check to see what was going on inside that crevasse, and they botched their roll. So they ended up falling in, and they took a couple points of damage and got stuck in there. And so that character, and you only have one move and one action. They're stuck, so they can't move. The investigation was their action. Now they're done. And then, so the team is doing their stuff. This character gets stuck in there, and then it's the world's turn, like at the end of everyone's turn, then the DM goes. And then a bunch of bugs come flooding into the area. So now the team is looking at, there's a bunch of bugs. We're going to have to get rid of these bugs, but one of our players is stuck inside the crevasse. What do you want to do? It's like, I want to go climb into the crevasse and try to pull my friend out. So of the five people, two of them are fucking around inside of this crevasse. And there's only three people. It's like, we have a whole wall of bugs here.
Right, you have
And so
to
they're doing really,
prioritize, right?
yeah. So they're having to split up. Like, how do they actually want to deal with stuff? But when everything is you have one action, but no matter what it is, you always have like that yes and or yes but. It's like
Yes.
they're always like you find out what's in that. Yeah, there's ore down there, but now you're stuck. So
Yeah.
what are you gonna do about it? You found what you wanted, but because you failed the die roll, I give you what you were looking for, but now you have this other problem. Like
Yes.
I wanna shoot that bug. Great, you shot that bug, but you botched your roll. So while you shot that, three more of them jumped on you, and now you're being attacked by a bunch of bugs in your face. What are you gonna do about that next turn?
Right.
So you can always keep moving the board forward, so there's never any stagnation. And with so many people, like having such short, tight action economy. Is like it takes like 3 minutes to go through an entire roster of three people, and now it's oh shit, it's my turn again. Okay, it's like there's no time
Right.
for phones, there's no time for it. It's like you got to pay attention because if that guy screws up, that might mean you just got hit in the head with a wrench.
Yeah, now you got to do something else. You thought you were going to be able to do this on your act. Now you have to react to that. Yeah,
Yeah,
that's
yeah,
good.
yeah.
It's
So,
nice.
but
It's
again,
nice.
it's just D20 plus modifier, but the narrative aspect is completely under control of the DM.
Yeah. And
It's
that's the wonderful thing. It's a, I tell kids and parents and their parents alike and adult players that are new, this is interactive storytelling. This is what we're doing.
Yeah.
I'm coming up with some ideas, but you guys are going to probably derail them or make more exciting things happen by whatever you're going to do. It's loose, like you have many, many options and
Yeah.
just do it. And then we'll have an interesting story because I've gotten to the point where I'll run the same module now back to back so that I have it in my head. So it's always in my back pocket in case like I'll show up tonight and if somebody's sick or something can't play, then I could just say, oh, I can DM this module that I already know and just make it happen. But what's more fun, that was the reason I did it. But what's interesting and fun about it is that now the same module, two different, complete, almost sometimes completely different reactions and different scenarios, and it's just
Yeah.
awesome. you know, depending on who's playing.
Absolutely. So. Fun stuff, man. Super.
All right. Well, Phil, we've been talking for over an hour, and this is great. I mean, we could talk for, sounds like we could talk for days. So we'll have to do this again. But so I'm going to put in the description of this video all the ways to contact you and get your stuff. And yeah, so it's been great to talk to you today.
I appreciate the invitation. So it's I saw your I saw you were streaming a recap on your Spelljammer.
Yeah.
And I love all things Spelljammer. I love seeing how people approach it, what they're doing with it, and it just helps feed my own inspiration to being able to build bigger and better things in the future. So
cool.
It's cool how much stuff you put out and the variety of things that you talk about. I love it. So it's
great. Oh, thanks. Well, I'm like you. Like I think I'm starting to realize that what the business model would be in order to have a successful YouTube channel, and I'm not doing any of that.
Same.
I'm doing whatever I want to do. So there's a lot of weird content on my channel, but I'm glad that somebody's looking at the D&D stuff. More and more people are. So there may be more and more D&D content on this channel. So
be very welcome from you. Absolutely.
All right, cool. All right, I'm going to stop the recording.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.